Hello and welcome to BYJU'S Exam Prep IAS. As part of a comprehensive news analysis, today we'll be discussing seven important articles out of the Hindu newspaper itself. Before we begin, first things first, we have a very important scholarship test which is happening on 2nd July at 11 a.m. You can get up to 90% scholarship, and more than that, you can check your strength and weaknesses both, because there's a detailed report card which comes through. So I hope that you're going to give this scholarship test. With this, let's look at the first thing, which is what are we going to discuss today in our session. So there are seven topics, three heavy, which is related to mains, and thereafter Prelims Bytes section, smaller topics where you have to only remember smaller facts itself. The first one is what was happening in Russia, what is the current state itself, a very interesting piece itself, and we'll try to understand what is this PWC Wagner and how does it impact the larger Russia-Ukraine crisis itself. Thereafter, we'll talk about the NIRF ranking. If you remember yesterday, we discussed NIRF, but we discussed a positive article which was talking about how Tamil Nadu is a very good model. This is on the other part of the spectrum where it talks about the issues in the NIRF ranking, and therefore these two articles together will help you write a very comprehensive answer in the mains examination. Thereafter, we will discuss a very important launch which is going to happen on 1st, which is dark energy and dark matter to be studied by a satellite called Elucide, and we will discuss what is dark energy, what is dark matter, how does it interact with the galaxy itself. Then we'll move to smaller sections, biofertilizer, we'll discuss a new market scheme for certain things related to how we can actually incentivize green energy and green activities itself. We will talk about a new apex body for research in India, and we'll end with just a very small fact about the ratio of NPA, which is non-performing assets, what the RBI's outlook has been towards it. So this is the basic seven topics we are going to cover. Please do remember the scholarship test, and once the session is over, you will have five questions at the Telegram channel itself. So do like, share and subscribe to the Telegram channel. So with this, let's begin our first topic. And here we need to understand the concept of Black Saturday and what is the PWC Wagner and the PMC Wagner concept itself. So before we go into the nitty-gritty, as we always do, I'll try to give you this basic concept, and then we'll talk about the implications and then the nitty-gritty itself. So the question is the PMC Wagner, sometimes also referred to as PWC Wagner, but PMC Wagner means Private Mercenary Contingent Wagner. Now, what is this PMC Wagner? This is the first question. So again, I'm going to go through the basics first. Thereafter, we will move into the nitty-gritty, and then we'll revise everything before we end this section itself. So PMC Wagner, the M is a very important word in this, which is mercenary. See, across history, there have been people who give you services vis-a-vis fighting or as soldiers. These are called mercenary soldiers. Mercenary soldiers you have seen throughout history with vis-a-vis the Marathas, even during the period of the Delhi Sultanate from Mughal, throughout Indian history, throughout world history. We have seen multiple forms of mercenary soldiers. Now, this PMC Wagner is based out of Russia, and actually is based on the Ukraine crisis, not the current one, but the 2014 one. Its inception comes when the Crimean Peninsula is invaded by Russia. And the person who started the PMC Wagner was a very important deputy of Putin himself. He, during the Soviet era, was actually in the jail. Then he came out. Then he started a restaurant, which was very, very important junction or point at which different personalities used to come. Even Putin, as the deputy mayor, used to come and eat in that restaurant. And thereafter, he went into this mercenary soldier business. So basically, the concept is they are contractors, and they will give you soldiers, and they hire people who want to fight in the army, but they don't want to be part of the institutionalized Russian army, rather want to be private contractors or private soldiers. So think of it as two very basic things: private contractors who hire soldiers and private soldiers who want to fight but do not want to be part of the army itself. So the PMC Wagner, PWC Wagner, both PMC Wagner is therefore a private body which actually has been helping Putin previously in the Crimean crisis, now in the Ukrainian crisis, but they mostly operate in Africa, as I will show you on a map. So the PMC Wagner was a private mercenary contingent which was fighting on the part of the Russians in the Ukrainian war. Now what happens on Saturday is what is called Black Saturday, is that the PMC Wagner actually mutinied or rebelled against the Russian army, against Putin himself, and they argued that we are not in this war for the basic aims which you have. And they did what is called March of Justice or March towards Moscow itself. But it was called off after 24 hours of major crisis in Russia itself. And as of right now, Putin has given three options to the soldiers which were in the PMC Wagner. PMC Wagner started as maximum 5,000 soldiers, but now is a very big contingent of 50,000 soldiers itself. So the basic point is, this is a private mercenary contingent fighting, started to fight first in Crimean Peninsula, thereafter is fighting in Ukraine as of right now, operates quite a lot in Africa, and the person who is related to it is actually quite close to Putin. And now initially it was said that Putin is going to prosecute everybody and everybody will go into jail, but that was dropped, and in response to this, the March to Justice was stopped. Now, what is the implication of this? If you've done world history, you would actually get a major deja vu moment in that regard, that this is something which was quite close to what happened in 1917 also, during the Russian Revolution, once the October Revolution happened, how the Mensheviks fought against the Bolsheviks itself, that major scene which was created in Russia after the Socialist Revolution happened. It shows that same signs, but the point is, Russia is not the same as 1917, and this Russia is more autocratic, and under Putin has been pushing into Ukraine illegally. So therefore, the reasons are equally interesting as much as their aims. The reasons why Wagner actually rebelled was because it said that there is corruption, the defense ministry is just putting the basic aim of their own interests into the hands of the Wagner group itself or the soldiers itself. They just want to exploit Ukraine, and therefore they are fighting for the wrong causes itself. And in that sense, this shows the internal political boil and crisis in Russia. So very simply, PMC Wagner, it's a mercenary group, it's a private army, was fighting for Putin, now is frustrated by how Ukraine is pushing back, has lost a lot of its soldiers on the Ukrainian front, therefore they wanted to capture power. A mutiny, a coup is not something which is ideal in any country, but in Russia it will become even more dangerous. Over and above that, as of right now, that march has been stopped, and Putin has said that either you go back home or you can join the Russian army, or you can go to Belarus if you want to and not operate in Russia itself. So the simple point is, this article tells you the present state, but I've given you a historical perspective also. The simple point is, PMC Wagner, private army, related to Putin, Crimea, thereafter, now Ukraine crisis, operates in Africa quite a lot, we'll discuss that, and thereafter, it rebelled or mutinied, or there was a coup attempt based on certain demands, wherein they wanted to come out of Ukraine itself. Deja vu moment for Russia. Russia has this basic tendency of how their military, private military armies actually capture power. Private militaries are nothing new in history itself. Throughout history, we have had mercenary soldiers, we've had militias, we've had different forms of private contractors who operate as personalities, who would recruit people to fight for them. And it's all about money. There's no basic congruence of nationalism. It's all about money. Mercenary soldiers and mercenary operators only work for money itself. Is this basic point clear? Because then we'll go into the nitty-gritty of this. I'm not giving you names as of right now. I'm not giving you details. I'm just trying to give you the basic picture of what is PMC Wagner and related to the other aspects of the crisis in Russia itself. Remember, PMC Wagner is the English spelling. PWC Wagner is the Russian spelling. And therefore, mostly we use PMC Wagner and not PWC Wagner. Okay, so let's talk about what happened on Saturday itself. So dramatic events unfold in Russia, where a private column of the Wagner group was moving towards Moscow to capture power itself. And as of right now, Russian army has been deployed in the Ukrainian front. So Putin did not have time to respond also. So he had to do something. It is very, very dangerous when these type of movements happen. And in a country like Russia, it is equally problematic for India because Putin has a good relationship with India. And if these type of groups capture power, it is detrimental to the larger story of, even if you want to call Russia a democracy then, but generally India-Russia relationships get very, very on very slippery slope and will be destabilized in the long run if such events happen in Russia. Now, the PMC Wagner is a mercenary organization, first appeared during the Crimean crisis itself. Thereafter, by 2022, it has now become a proper company, operates out of St. Petersburg itself. And it is a simple concept. It is a network of contractors that supply soldiers for hire, and group got registered as a company, proper company. It's a registered company in Russia itself. Their basic point is they deal in war, they deal in soldiers. Now, they mostly operated initially and have been operating in Africa quite a lot. Close to 5,000 soldiers were deployed. But during the Russia-Ukraine crisis, 50,000 soldiers have now been deployed by Russia under the Wagner group itself. Now, in each of the countries where they have been involved, in 2014, it was Ukraine, Crimea. This was one of the most successful campaigns for them. Then they moved into Russia and registered themselves, started to basically become a proper company. Then they moved to Syria, Libya, Sudan, the Central African Republic, Mozambique, and Mali. So therefore, they have been operating throughout Africa in different capacities. And their basic point is either the dictators have been recruiting them or the counter-terrorist measures have been recruiting them. They have been, that way, mostly on the wrong side of the story, wherein, as of right now, the EU has also prosecuted the Wagner group for doing extrajudicial killing, and it is mostly that they are employed by the wrong side of the story rather than the right side of the story. As it is, Russia-Ukraine, Russia represents the wrong side itself. So when we talk about the PMC Wagner, it is operating, it has been operating quite a lot, and it's not something new. And therefore, the person who is involved, he is very, very close to Putin. And this is like a stab in the back movement for Putin himself. So the chief, his name, Y. Prigozhin, he is the one who came out of a USSR jail, started a restaurant, became a major, what we call as convergence point of all different personalities. Under Putin's guidance became very, very important and was extremely important for the Crimean Peninsula annexation. Now, for Putin, it is a stab in the back. For Putin, it is dangerous also because mutinying armies during war is something not good, and Ukraine can push further also into Russia. And therefore, it is an unprecedented act, but in a way, nothing new for Russia also. It's unprecedented in the present context. Nobody had actually predicted that this was going to happen in this crisis itself. So the saga continues. However, the problem in this story is that Putin has been able to somehow subdue them. Because for Ukraine and for EU, for NATO, this was a very good development. But for India, it is not, because a destabilized Russia is not good, because then we become too dependent on the US itself. But as I said, it's nothing new, because we've seen this type of development in 1917 itself. Russia has this history of coups, of civil wars, and therefore this gives you that chilling feeling of the civil war which we see between 1917 to 22-24 in Russia itself after the Russian Revolution. So for Putin, it is concerning. It's a stab in the back moment, and more than that, when the motherland is fighting, he believes that this was unnecessary. But for you and me, what is more important is that what are the reasons why the Wagner group actually rebelled? And the reasons tell you what is happening in Russia as of right now. What they quote very straightforward is that there is corruption, nothing new, oligarchs and Russia works like that only. Second is poor decisions. This is where Wagner group is saying that we are taking the brunt, that poor decisions have been taken on the front line. Russia has never been good in fighting wars. If you've again gone through the basic world history, you would know that be it the Crimean War, be it the Great Eastern Crisis, be it with Japan, Russo-Japanese War, or be it the First World War, it is only the Second World War where they were able to actually absorb the Nazi power itself. But before that, all wars, Russia has always been very lethargic and they've always taken strategically wrong decisions. So this is again something where we see a deja vu moment. So if you've gone through Russian Revolution, if you've gone through the history of the First World War, Second World War, you would think that it's the same story playing out. And that would be true in that sense, because Russia has always been like that when it comes to wars. So very simply, the poor decision making at the front line, what is happening is the Wagner group is taking the brunt and they're losing soldiers. And that is creating a lot of frustration. And for a mercenary soldier losing a battle, simple point is that he is fighting for money. He has no concept of Russian nationalism. So therefore, he's not fighting for the motherland. And if they are going to lose a lot of their employees, soldiers, then what is going to happen is that they will get frustrated. And Wagner Group is actually embodying that frustration. Further, Russians generally have lost a lot of their soldiers in this battle. Ukraine have been using very effectively whatever equipment NATO has given to them, and therefore the airstrikes are not working, the long range artillery is not working, and generally the Ukrainians have used drone technology very, very well to actually counter the Russians in the larger context of this battle. Further, there are two accusations that the defense minister, he just wants to push his personal ambition, and they just want to exploit Ukrainian resources. Again, this is like stating the obvious. Russia is not there to fight with Ukraine over nationalism. It's all about resources. It's all about the strategic position of Ukraine. So therefore, this is something which is, again, not new to us in India, because we've seen that. This is standard. And if you analyze the whole story of the Russia-Ukraine crisis, it is all about resources also. And it is about Putin's ego also. So very simply, when we talk about this crisis, it was inevitable, but we never saw it from a mercenary group. We were expecting the Russian army to do it. And at the end of the day, this is concerning for Putin and for us also, because this is now going to further destabilize. Now, this is the beginning of the end in that regard. It's not the end itself. Now, what is the present state? The present state is that Putin has said that I will not prosecute anybody who was marching towards Moscow. I will not actually prosecute even the person who is the mastermind of this. I give you an option. Either you sign a contract with the Ministry of Defense, become a soldier itself, or you return home from wherever you came as a mercenary soldier, or you go to Belarus, where I will give you safe haven in that regard. Now, the simple point is, he is pumping them up that they all are freedom fighters. They are in fighting. They've showed their nationalism. Putin is concerned, and this should be concerning him in that regard. Now, before we move to the second article, let me try to give you a basic overview of this article. Very simple, straightforward, but gives you a very interesting perspective. Straightforward, PMC Wagner is a mercenary soldier private army, first. Second, it is based on the concept of contractors, money, and soldiers. Therefore, there's no concept of nationalism here. Next, very simply, they started in 2014, Crimean Peninsula, a very good campaign for them. Thereafter, started to operate in Africa, where they have been on the wrong side mostly. Then, in this war, they have played a very important role. 50,000 soldiers have been involved. And very simply, these 50,000, there is a lot of casualty. Wagner Group starts to develop frustration based on corruption, wrong decisions, bad tactical decisions itself. The strategy is wrong when it comes to Ukraine itself. Ukraine also countermeasures are very strong. And therefore, they rebelled, marched towards Moscow, the March of Justice. Thereafter, stopped within 24 hours. By Sunday evening, everything was diffused. But the fact that this basic mutiny coup moment came through is a very dangerous trend in Russian politics. And we as Indians and generally the world is now monitoring Russia quite a lot, because this is not the end. This is just the beginning of more and more cracks developing within Russia. So the diffusion of this basic crisis does not mean that there is no crisis in Russia now. And the simple solution which Putin has done, I will not prosecute, I will not arrest, I will not do anything. You go where you want to go. But the Wagner group is now not involved directly in this war in that regard. So clear, everyone? No issues with regards to what is PMC Wagner or PWC Wagner, or the concept of what is their reason for mutinying, where, how are they related to the larger Russia-Ukraine crisis, where have we been operating, and what is the basic place where we place this larger crisis. Russia has had a history of this, and now next time when you do read Russian Revolution or do you do world history, you have to make sure that you pay a little bit of attention to Russian civil war. Because now civil war will become something relevant, because this is a civil war type position only. And Russia saw this when they were disintegrating in 1991-92 also. They've seen it in 1917 also. And now in 2023, because of the Ukraine crisis, we see it again. So this is the basic point. Okay, three options, straightforward, go to Belarus or go home. We will not do anything. Or you can also, if you want to fight further, you become a soldier within the Russian army. This is the present situation. Let us see how this develops further. So this is the first topic. Now we move to the second one, which is the NIRF rankings. Now, if you remember, we discussed this yesterday also, and we discussed the basic parameters in which the NIRF rankings work, which is teaching, learning, resources, the graduation outcomes, the research and professional practices, the outreach inclusivity, and the perception. This is the basic five parameters in which they work. And the rankings have been now close to 8 years of this, but the basic point of the matter is NIRF rankings have now become very, very important marker of the education system. But this article again points out major loopholes in it. So yesterday was more about how Tamil Nadu has succeeded. Now we have to see the other part of the story. So yesterday's CNA and today, when you bring both of them together, then you get a holistic answer in that regard. And that holistic answer is how it is good, but there are loopholes also. So again, let's try to understand the basic points which have been made in this article. Now, it says that though the number of institutions have been rising in the NIRF rankings, because as I told you yesterday, you have to actually voluntarily become a part of this ranking. So you have to actually qualify, you have to say that, yes, I want to be audited in that regard vis-a-vis these five parameters itself. So you decide yourself that you want to be part of it or not. Now, the first point which the author makes, and he is not coming from any random colleges from IIT Madras itself. The first point he says is that only 12.3% of all institutions in India have actually taken part in this whole process. So what it argues that very simply, in India, as per 2021 data, the All India Survey on Higher Education, there are close to 1,113 universities and 43,796 colleges. However, only 12.3% of these institutions have actually signed up for NIRF, which is a very dismal number. So close to 87% of all institutions in which most of the population is actually, or most of the students are enrolled, they have not been evaluated. So therefore, the sample size itself is a problem. That we can't just be evaluating the good institutions and not talking about the institutions in which most of the students actually are enrolled. So the first issue is the very small sample size. 12.3% of all institutions in India are actually under the purview of this basic ranking, which is extremely narrow that way. Second, it says that there is a skew. The skew we discussed yesterday also, that Tamil Nadu, Kerala, all of these states have this concentration of these colleges. However, the major population of students, the higher education, are in UP, are in MP, are in Bihar, out of which the institutions have not been ranked only. And therefore, there's a major spatial differentiation, or as we discussed yesterday, hotspots of education, which is not a good thing, which is not a good thing, because at the end of the day, this does not prove that education in India is good. It only proves that certain pockets are good. And that only creates burden on the students because they have to then travel to these hotspots to do something. The third argument which the article makes is very straightforward and simple, which is on the concept of quality and quantity. Which is that when we look at the research papers, for example, the 12.3% institutions which are actually been taken into the purview, they do 90% of all research papers, which is problematic. 90% of all research papers in India come out of 12.3% of the institutions. This is a problem because this means that most of the colleges which are under NIRF are not publishing anything. And what is interesting is that the management colleges, there was no research paper only. It was only engineering colleges or the humanities colleges which actually were writing research papers. Further, there's an issue of rural urban. The survey which we are talking about says that most of the colleges in India and most of the universities are in rural areas. But this NIRF ranking actually is skewed towards urban. And the last most important point which it talks about is faculty ratio. It says that very simply, the colleges which are top ranking, the faculty ratio is very favorable, which is faculty to student ratio. However, when we go into the lower ranked colleges, the ratio is dismal. And therefore, this means that the data itself is skewed. And last but not the least, private institutions are also part of this NIRF ranking, and that also dominates the ranking generally itself. So when we talk about this ranking, prima facie it looks good. But the point is, when we look at the sample size, when we look at the state-based data, when we look at the research papers, when we look at the rural-urban divide, when we look at the faculty ratio, when we look at the private-public divide, everywhere we see problems. Now again, a lot of data is there, but these are the 5 points which you need to remember. Because if these 5 points you will be able to remember, you will be able to write a good answer for a critically analyzed type question. That are there issues, you have to elucidate. And yes, there are issues. Sample size is an issue. Hotspot of education is an issue. The issue of quality, the issue of quantity, the issue of faculty, the issue of research papers, and the issue of private and public. So please try to understand these smaller details here. Don't learn the data. The only data you learn is 12.3%. Thereafter, everything else, you just have to concentrate on the issue itself. So if you understand again the core issue of this article, then we'll go into the nitty-gritty. Do you understand the 5 basic issues it is pointing out? Yes, no? Yes, okay, perfect. So, let's talk about the issues. The first issue is that close to 5,543 institutions were offering themselves for this ranking itself. And in all, total applications did not exceed more than 8,600, which is 8,600. Now, if you go by the AISHE data 2021, this means only 12.3% of all institutions in India have come under the purview of this ranking. 87.7% of higher institutions, which should be of matter of concern for us, have not been actually evaluated only. Now, this further shows a problem where in 43% of all universities and 61% of all colleges are in rural area. However, there is again an urban bias in this ranking. So the first issue is the very small sample size. The second issue is the urban bias, wherein the rural institutions have not been evaluated itself. Thereafter, the second major issue is quality and quantity, wherein the large states, which have most of the students have performed dismally, and this is not something to be very proud of. So the 81% of high quality colleges are only in three states, and therefore the mission should be to improve the three states, not the three states, but the states which are not the top ranking in that regard. So the simple point is, it should be a major mission of the Ministry of Education now to make sure that these hotspots are diffused. And therefore, there's a problem with regards to how we have created pockets of education. Then comes the issue of private. There is, in the highest ranking institutions, 15 private institutions, and thereafter in university rankings, 6 are private institutions, which is quite a lot of private institutions within a public concept itself. So the government run colleges are not performing well, though that is technically not true except for certain institutions, but overall it shows this type of picture. So first, the issue related to hotspots, and second, the issue related to private sector actually having a major chunk in the NIRF rankings. And you know what these private institutions do, because 87.7% of all institutions are not taking part in this. So what is happening is that these institutions, these private colleges, are saying, see, we are NIRF ranked 8, 10, then they are trying to bring in the students and use this NIRF ranking to take as much money as possible, which is not good. Because if the whole picture is seen, the holistic analysis is done, they're actually not even in the top 20 or top 100 in that regard. But because there's a very small sample size, there is a bias towards urban and private institutions. And private institutions will then wear it as a badge of honor and then ask for any amount of fees from anybody. And students and parents also get influenced by this. And therefore, in the era of digital ranking and everything we rank, it will become a problem, because then you are exploiting students. So when first we see the small sample size, then we see the urban bias generally, then we see the hotspot, and then we see the private bias. Thereafter, we don't stop here. Here comes the faculty strength and ranking itself. When we talk about the top 100, there's a major mismatch if you look at the NIRF ranking. See, the average number of faculty in top 100 universities is 645, while in the remaining it is only 242, which is very dismal number for a university and a college, very, very small number. Thereafter, in the case of colleges, 173 teachers in top 100, thereafter 71 in the remaining institutions. This means just creating a basic building does not do anything. So this is again a problem. And if you add to it the research papers, then you will realize only 12.3% of all institutions are contributing 90% of the public, or what we call as the research papers itself. And in that sense, the simple point of the matter is that most of these institutions are not doing research. In management, 50% of institutions which applied did not publish even one paper. Not even one paper. And this is something very concerning, very, very concerning that way, because this means that they are just there as institutions, not helping students learn or do research. And R&D is the future. With such a great demographic dividend for India, if we are not doing research and development, if we are not doing research, we are basically wasting it. So what should we do? What should we do? What is the way forward? And the way forward is very straightforward. We have to urgently increase the quality of education in not the top 100, but the next 1,000, 2,000 institutions. And further, we have to make sure that our scientific publications are increasing and all these participating bodies are doing it. What we can do is that we can actually increase the weightage of research. By increasing the weightage itself, what will happen is that the colleges will start to do that more, so as to come higher up in the NIRF rankings. So before I go to the last mains based topic itself, let me give you an overview of what we've done till this point. We first understood the PMC-Wagner concept, the private mercenary army, the crisis which happened in Russia itself, thereafter what is the implication of that, the reasons for it. And second, we saw the NRF rankings yesterday. If you will see, the tone of the article was very congratulatory. Tamil Nadu is the best. It was talking about the hotspots in a very good way. Here we see a contrasting article next day itself in the newspaper. This is why reading the newspaper regularly is important. As soon as you see the second article, you see, okay, it is talking about the issues. Research papers are not being published by most of these institutions. The problem is in the faculty ratio after the top 100, the issue of rural bias, the urban bias, the issue of private bias, and the extremely small sample size, which means that most of this data is irrelevant, and just NIRF is about patting on the back that yes, I'm first, but not all institutions have been taken into consideration itself. Out of all the colleges, if only 12% are participating, makes no sense. Yes, can we now move to the last major topic vis-a-vis dark matter and illicit? Yes? Okay, perfect. Now, we come to the most important concept, where is dark matter, dark energy, and the rocket which is going to take off from the Euclid space telescope, which is going to be launched via Falcon 9 rocket of the SpaceX. Now, let me give you an overview of what is the basic concept here. See, Euclid is a very important telescope which the European Space Agency is launching. First, please pay attention. Second, its primary objective is to understand dark energy, dark matter, two different things. Now, there's other details related to, smaller details related to it, does not really matter to us. What is dark energy and what is dark matter? Because now they become relevant generally. Now, when we talk about dark energy and dark matter, see, there's something called the visible universe. We are part of the visible universe. For example, we are on Earth, it emits light, and through the James Webb telescope, through different telescopes, through different forms of satellites, we have been able to observe the universe. We have been able to observe galaxies. We've been able to understand the basic form of the universes, of celestial bodies, of meteorites, of asteroids. We've seen that. We've understood black holes now a lot in that regard. We've also understood relativity. We've understood gravity also in that sense. Now, the very simple point here is, then what is dark matter and then what is dark energy? Let's first try to understand what is dark matter. See, dark matter, very simply, these two concepts are not very clearly defined in science as of right now. We know what is not dark matter and what is not dark energy, but I can give you a basic understanding of it. Dark matter, basically, if you look at the pictures which you've ever seen of the space itself, if you've seen galaxies, you would see that you have a certain galaxy, you have certain galaxies, and then you have empty spaces. And you have empty spaces which is the dark part, the black part. That black part, you think of it as dark matter. Basically, it is a matter which does not absorb energy, it does not absorb light itself, but it does interact with one thing which tells us that it is there, which is gravity. Because when it comes to gravity itself, it starts to warp that area in such a way that even light starts to bend around it. So it does not emit light, it does not emit energy, but it does interact with gravity in such a way that it has the property of bending light itself. So what we see is that if there is a lot of concentration of dark matter in certain spaces, it will start to warp that space, and therefore the light will start to bend a little bit. This has been observed. We have no other idea what it is, but think of it as the aspect of when you see a canvas of the universe, if this whole slide is the universe, whatever is behind me is the universe, and if I'm marking certain galaxies, The purple part which you see behind me is basically dark matter. The filling, whatever is there, the filling part, the dark part, that is what's called dark matter itself. It is basically matter which is not, as I said, we know more about what it is not, which is not part of the observable universe. We all are made out of matter, but this matter absorbs energy, is able to reflect light also, is able to absorb light also. But this matter has certain properties. Is it a part of space itself? It is a property of this space, or is it something related to matter trying to change its form itself? We have no idea. It is not antimatter, because antimatter, when it interacts with matter, creates what is called as gamma radiation, which is not happening. So it's a little bit technical in that regard, but think of it like this. Whatever is behind me, you see, all purple is basically your dark matter. And these are galaxies which are spinning around their suns or their basic stars itself, and they represent matter. So is first thing, tell me, dark matter clear? Dark matter, as it says, matter which only interacts with gravity, has the property of even warping gravity in that regard. Warping would be to distort gravity. Yes, okay. Now, then what is dark energy? Now, dark energy is actually the concept of an energy which is counteracting gravity in that regard. See, there is gravity in all of these different galaxies. And if you know now, because of the way we understand black holes and of the major discoveries which have happened recently, we know that whenever a celestial body is in space, it tends to then warp that space itself. That creates a certain force, that is gravity. Now, gravity tends to pull together. And what we thought was that the universe was contracting, and at one point of time, all gravity will come together in one space, and the universe will come together at one point. Basically, the Big Bang created it, and thereafter everything will bring, the gravity will push everything together. However, what we see is that it's the opposite. Somehow the universe is expanding, and the expansion of the universe is actually based on dark energy. There is an energy in the space which is basically pushing the universe outside. So think of it like this, that basically there's a pushing force which is dark energy. Dark energy, when it pushes, it basically creates more dark matter. And in that sense, the push factor is dark energy. And what comes in between, once you push, what is filling it up is dark matter itself. 68%, it is believed, of all the universe is actually dark energy. And 28 to 27% is dark matter itself. And only 9 to 5% of everything is matter, what we see, the observable universe itself. So again, I'll try to basically summarize this. Dark energy is the concept of a force which is counteracting the gravity of all universes coming together and is expanding the universe itself. Dark matter is the matter which fills up, or is the basic matter which is not observable or is not absorbing energy with regards to light. It interacts with gravity, and we have to go further, and this is why this rocket is very important. The Falcon 9 taking this satellite is very important, because this is the basic point which ESA wants to do, which is to understand it better. We have very limited understanding of these two things, but whatever it was, I hope now you do understand what is dark energy and dark matter. So when we talk about the mission itself, the mission is trying to find the missing pieces in the cosmic puzzle itself. And the telescopes on board, will, when they will become operational, they will start to now observe the sky, the space itself. And they want to understand what is this cosmic energy, what is this dark matter, and what is this concept of dark energy itself. So the mission hopes to understand the evolution of the universe by looking at the light emitting from the different galaxies 10 billion years ago. The telescope will focus on understanding dark matter and dark energy. Astronomers know very little of what is dark matter and dark energy. The concept has been pushed through since the past 25 years itself, but we believe that whilst gravity should bring everything together, it is dark energy which is expanding the universe, and therefore scientists, what they believe, that the expansion of the universe is happening because of dark energy. Therefore 68% of the universe is made out of dark energy and 27% is made out of dark matter itself. Whatever is left is what is called ferronomic matter, or the things such as earth, planets, asteroids, what matter you can see in that regard. And it has been named after a Greek mathematician, Euclid of Alexandria. The mission, as I said, very straightforward: understand the origin of these two basic forces or basic properties of space itself. And since 2007, the ESA, the European Space Agency, has been pushing quite a lot and is trying to understand different methods of how to understand dark matter, dark energy. The Hadron Collider itself has given us certain types of understanding about black holes, but we still need to go further in this basic story. So before we move on to the Prelims Bytes section, we've done three basic topics, and I'm going to give you an overview of that, and then we'll move into very small section. First, we tried to understand the PMC Wagner, how PMC Wagner therefore is related to Russia, how it is a private mercenary group, has been operating in Africa, Ukraine, a lot of casualties, frustration, march of justice, in turn creates a major rebellious position, or what we call as a mutiny type position in that regard. Second, we try to understand the problems in the NIRF. We discuss the concept of the urban bias, the problem of private bias, the concept of no research paper from most of the institutions. We discuss the skewed nature of hotspots itself and the very small sample size. And this was more about understanding what we call as dark matter and dark energy. This topic is very small, but I wanted to discuss dark matter and dark energy with you because that becomes relevant. Dark matter, as I said, is based on the concept of the space which we cannot observe. It is invisible matter in that regard, and we have dark energy which is counteracting the gravity of all these universes and all the different what we call as galaxies. And in that sense, this is going to be a major breakthrough once launched into the orbit itself. Clear, everybody? Energy, matter, NIRF, and PMC Wagner. Yes, perfect. Now we can look at the smaller topics. The first one, very straightforward. Just have to remember PM Pranam, which is that there has been a cabinet committee meeting on economic affairs, which has approved the Prime Minister Program for Restoration, Awareness, Generation, Nourishment and Immunization of Mother Earth. Basically, it's a biofertilizer scheme wherein we have been using a lot of fertilizers, but they're based on basic chemicals. Though they add nitrogen, potassium into the soil itself, but it is extremely toxic for the soil and is very, very bad in the long run for the soil and generally causes soil pollution. And therefore we are introducing biofertilizers under PM Pranam, and that will help us in making sure that the soil is saved, promote sustainable balanced use of fertilizers, and all state governments have to participate. So just remember that they have now approved finally this scheme called PM Pranam. The name does not give you the aspect of biofertilizers, so please do remember that it is related to biofertilizers. This has been now given an outlay of close to 3 lakh crores, which is a very big amount and is a very good concept vis-a-vis the direction we need to go with regards to fertilizers itself. This is the first thing. Second, something which the Ministry of Earth Sciences and basically the Ministry of Climate Change and the Ministry of Environment has brought up, which is to incentivize green activities. Now here the concept is green credit scheme. So the Environment Ministry, along with collaboration with Earth Sciences itself, has proposed, this is the concept of green credit scheme. Green credit scheme says that we will give certain credit to people for doing green activities, and if you do that, you can then redeem these credits for money. So basically, it's like a cashback scheme. So if you afforest, you will get certain amount of credits, which you can go and get it encashed in that regard via the government itself. So it tries to incentivize a host of activities, including afforestation, water conservation, water management, what we call as controlling air pollution, by giving them credits, and these credits can be traded for money. The Green Credit Scheme has been launched to leverage more and more people getting an incentive to work for the environment, and therefore competitive market-based approach on green credits. We've seen green credits at an international level, but here it is happening at the domestic level itself. So you and me, if we start a company and we do something good for the environment, we can get credits for it and then we can encash it. This creates a private business out of it, basically. And in that regard, what is more important to you is what are the activities which will give you these credits. So tree plantation, water-based green credit for water conservation, water harvesting basically is very good, because if you are now constructing a house and you're doing water harvesting, then you can get credits which you can redeem. So therefore you are encouraged to have a water harvesting system in your house itself. Thereafter, sustainable agriculture, land restoration and waste management. Therefore they've identified 8 different sectors in which you can gain certain credit which you can encash. This is still at the conceptualizing phase, and we will see that how does this actually materialize in the grassroots reality or in the long run in that regard. So first topic, very straightforward, the PM Pranam scheme. Second is a green credit scheme itself. Individuals and communities can get credit which can be encashed, incentivizing green activity. Thereafter, a very important bill has been passed and a new apex body has come up, which is the National Research Foundation. So very simply, the Union Cabinet has approved the National Research Foundation Bill 2023. This will create an apex body for high-level strategic decisions when it comes to scientific research in the country under the new education scheme or the new education policy itself. And very simply, 50,000 crores has been outlaid for this. What will happen is that the old institution which was there, which is the SERB, which is Science and Engineering Research Board, this will go out. But what is more important for you is how does the administrative structure work? So very simply, it will be a department under the Department of Science and Technology. Over and above that, the Prime Minister is going to be ex officio president of this board, the Union Ministers of Science and Technology, Education ex officio vice presidents, and it will bring in on the executive boards, the principal scientific advisor and different other stakeholders. So therefore, it is related to the government very closely, and even the Prime Minister is involved vis-a-vis decision making when it comes to scientific research. This is very good. This is very, very good, because we do need an apex body which can bring all of the different aspects related to research together, and we have some direction in that. Last but not the least is a very simple point which I want to point out to you, which is that the RBI has pointed out in its biannual financial stability report, and this is very encouraging in that regard, that for the first time the gross non-performing assets, which is mostly defaulted loans in that regard, that has shown a downward trend and has reached the lowest point in 10 years at 3.9%, and the net non-performing assets ratio has declined to 1%. This is the only thing which I want to point out to you. Other than that, yes, Indian economy is resilient in the larger context of global headwinds in that sense. So before we look at the mains questions, let's discuss everything what we've done in this session itself. First, we discussed the very simple concept of the PMC Wagner and how is it related to Russia, the problems it is facing, its mutiny, the march of justice or the march towards Moscow. Second, we discussed the NIRF rankings and its problems, how it is related to the urban bias, the concept of private bias, it has the ratio of faculties is problematic, the issues related to how the faculty ratio is also translating into publications, and other than that, a very small sample size. Thereafter, dark energy and dark matter. Dark energy is an counteracting force to gravity, which is expanding the universe, and dark matter is rather the invisible matter which is there, which warps gravity so as to show us that it is there. Then we discussed four basic concepts: PM Pranam, NPAs have declined, the concept of a green credit scheme, and the simple NRF, National Research Foundation. Is all of this clear? If it is, then we'll move to the mains question and end the session. Yes? Okay. Perfect. So, the Wagner Group has revealed the fault lines in Russian politics. Comment. A straightforward question, but GS paper 2 it can come. Second is, there are multiple issues in the NIRF rankings. Do you agree? Again, a very open-ended question, straightforward. Again, can be done. This is GS paper 2 and 3, both you can expect in that regard. So, with this, I would like to end the session. I will see you tomorrow, again, with another set of issues. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.